W.F. Howes presents an unabridged recording of No Place to Hide by J.S. Monroe, narrated by Sam Stafford. For Hillary, Felix, Maya, and Jago. Faustus. For the vain pleasure of 24 years hath Faustus lost eternal joy and felicity. I writ them a bill with mine own blood. The date is expired. This is the time, and he will fetch me. Christopher Marlowe, Dr. Faustus. The new camera appeared last week. Perched high above the platform in Wiltshire, it watches the early morning commuters like a heron waiting for fish. Patient. Predatory. Two women hurry past, unaware they're being observed, keen to secure seats on the London train. Behind them, a late runner jumps on board between the closing doors. He slumps down by the window, breathless, sweaty, staring back at the receding camera. Up in southeast London, a helicopter arcs across a grey sky, the clatter of its blades cutting through the din of rush hour traffic. Effortlessly, it banks back towards a busy junction, losing height as it approaches. A woman taps on her steering wheel, checks her baby daughter in the car seat beside her, smiles at her son in the rearview mirror. She glances up at the traffic lights, but it's the helicopter that has her attention, hovering in front of her like a behemoth, a sleek camera slung beneath its belly. Further south, in Lewisham, a courier driver is already running behind with important medical supplies for the hospital. It's a temperature-controlled delivery, and he hopes he's not too late. A dash cam points towards the road ahead. Another is angled back at his face. Keen to make up time, he accelerates, brakes too suddenly, cursing the car in front of him, and the AI technology that will slash his pay. Meanwhile, over in Cambridge, a student locks up his bike, chatting with a female friend. He seems relaxed, almost carefree, as he strides across the college courtyard, catching at spilled anatomy lecture notes. Outside the porter's lodge, a CCTV camera, fixed to the ancient wall like a giant insect, clocks their arrival. His friend walks inside, but he hesitates, studying the camera. Deep within its lens, a tiny red light pulses impassively. Chapter 1. What's the time, Mr. Wolf? Adam counts to 20 paces before he glances up at the security camera. Yesterday, he barely managed 10. When he was a child, he used to love the thrill of the stop-start steps, the mounting tension. Dinner time. But he's not playing games now. If only his life were so simple. The camera appeared a month ago, at the bottom of his road, impaled on a 30-foot steel pole. Sometimes the lens moves, angling its Orwellian gaze on the local youths who gather below. Every time Adam leaves the house, he tries to ignore it, walk past without looking up, counting his paces like a child. But he can't. He has to stop, convinced that the cameras started to watch him too, which is ridiculous. He's a law-abiding citizen. Makes sick children better. Not exactly a crack dealer.
I'm tired,
Freddy, his 5-year-old son, says, tugging at Adam's sleeve. Tired? Adam says. How can you possibly be tired, monkey? We've barely made it out the front door. Earlier, Freddy announced that he wanted to walk to the park today, but now he wishes to be carried. And who is Adam to refuse? He scoops Freddy up onto his shoulders, at the same time wedging one foot under their jogging pram's back wheel to stop it rolling down Mays Hill. He knows he's a soft touch. Too soft, according to his wife, Tanya. I've got it, Adam says, as Tanya offers to take the pram. Their six-month-old daughter, Tilly, has finally given in to sleep after a busy night. Tanya lifts up her hands in mock surrender. She's exhausted, tired to the core. Tilly's still breastfeeding, and Freddy's been playing up all week. Sorry, Adam says, letting her take the pram. Freddy buries his hands deep in his dad's hair, kneading it like Play-Doh. Adam tries to do everything at weekends, which only seems to make things worse.
How I manage without you is a mystery, Tanya says as they continue down the road in the spring sunshine.
A gentle breeze is blowing in from the south. Before they had children, Saturday mornings used to be a highlight of their week. Lie-ins and lovemaking, followed by runs along the towpath, moseying around the market, drinks at the Cutty Sark Inn. Now it's the playground in Greenwich Park, the soft play area on Creek Road if it's raining. The camera's doing a good job, Adam says, looking up at its menacing dark glass. He hasn't told Tanya that he thinks it's filming him. No trouble? The guy in the corner shop says it's not a police camera, Tanya says as they turn off into the park. It's true. There's no official sign. Nothing to say who actually erected it. MI5, apparently, she adds. He would say that. Adam has to listen to a new conspiracy theory every time he pops in for a pint of milk. But he still can't resist another glance back at the camera after he lowers Freddy to the ground. Has it moved? Changed angle? It's no good. He should seek proper help. Accept how bad things have become, that he's convinced he's being observed every hour of every day. Filmed. Last week, he even asked a colleague in psychiatry about it. Scopophobia. A fear of being watched, his colleague said, rather pompously. Own it and become an actor. Actors love being watched. That's the irony. Adam was an actor once, when he was a medical student. But he couldn't tell the psychiatrist that university was where it all began. He's never been able to tell anyone. 5 minutes later, on the bench together with a couple of coffees, they watch Freddy run about the playground. Tilly is still asleep in the pram beside them, which doesn't bode well for later. At least it gives Tanya a break. Adam's desperate to launch Freddy skywards on the swings, spin him dizzy on the roundabouts, but he knows that Tanya wants to talk. I think I'll go down to Mum and Dad's this afternoon, she says, tucking a strand of her long, light brown hair behind an ear. They haven't seen the kids for weeks. Today, Adam says, failing to hide his disappointment. The plan had been for her to go on Monday, but he doesn't want another row with Tanya. There have been enough of those in recent weeks. Of course. That's fine, he adds, feeling sick. He so wants Tanya to be happy, but it's as if a light has gone out in her life and he doesn't know how to switch it back on. If you're not too tired, I could drive you down. Take the train back? I'm fine, she says. They sit in silence, watching a group of women jog past. When he and Tanya used to go running together, they synced their Bluetooth headphones to the same playlist. It felt like they were in a movie, in a good way. I just need some time, she says quietly, sipping on her coffee. You always say that you want me to be happy, but you also don't want our kids to be brought up by strangers. Tanya, that's... I just miss my job, that's all, she says, interrupting him. Tanya was a successful GP before she had children, a professional, independent woman. And you're better with the kids than I am, she adds. Before he can answer, Adam spots someone on the far side of the playground, filming him on his phone. His mouth dries, pulse starts to quicken. Could it be him? Instinctively, he stands up, considers his options,
The man is in his 40s, and Adam's sure he recognizes him from university. What is it? Tanya asks, looking up at him. Perhaps he's imagining it. Nothing, Adam says, about to sit down. The man turns to walk away, but then he stops and holds his phone up in their direction again. It is him. Won't be a moment. Adam sets off at a brisk pace through the playground, focused on the man, clenching and unclenching his fists, trying to ignore the adrenaline sluicing through his body. He manages to smile at a fellow dad by the swings as he passes, keen not to create a scene. The man with the phone is dressed in a black t-shirt and black jeans. Adam's sure it's him. The familiar hawkish face and sickly pallor. The same unmistakable air of menace. Excuse me, Adam says as he approaches. The man is lost in his phone, half turned away from him, and hasn't seen Adam. Were you filming me just now, when I was over there? You what? The man looks up. It's not him. Shit. Adam knows at once he's made a terrible mistake. I'm so sorry. Adam surveys the playground. A little boy runs over from the sandpit and wraps his arms around the man's legs. Forgive me. I thought you were someone else. The man gives him a derisive look and walks off with the child, glancing over his shoulder as if Adam's a madman. He was filming his own son. Chapter 2.
Are you going on a run, Daddy?
Freddy asks as Adam stretches his calf muscles. Adam glances across at Tanya, still sitting on the park bench. She gives him a tired smile. Just a quick one. A little scamper around the park with Tilly, he says, to keep her asleep.
Can I come?
Freddy squints up at Adam in the sunshine. You stay here with Mummy.
But I want to come with you.
Adam crouches down until he's at eye level with Freddy. I know you do. And I want to go running with you too, if I can keep up. What have you got in those trainers of yours? Secret jet-powered rockets?
Don't be silly, Daddy. Why can't I come?
He checks on Tanya and lowers his voice. Because right now, Mummy's a little bit tired. Your sister here seems to like being awake at night and asleep during the day. Topsy-turvy Tilly. I think that's what we should call her from now on, don't you? So I want you to look after Mummy while I go for a quick run. And then you and I will speed around the park later. Adam turns away. No, they won't. Tanya's taking Freddy and Tilly to her parents this afternoon. He wishes she'd go on Monday, after they've all had a happy weekend together, like a normal family.
Okay,
Freddy says reluctantly, hanging on to the second syllable. Adam looks across at Tanya, who's cupping her coffee, staring into the middle distance. Back in 10 minutes, he calls out, but they both ignore him. He tells himself he's looking after Tilly as he strides off across the bottom of the park, giving Tanya a proper break. In truth, he just wants to run, release some of the pent-up tension of recent weeks. At the top of the park, where he and Tanya once gathered for the London Marathon, Tilly begins to cry. They couldn't be further away from her mother's milk, if hunger is the problem. Taking her out of the pram, he rests her against his shoulder, holding her tiny body in his big hands to shield her from the breeze, gusting now from the southwest. His dad taught him how to read the wind when he was learning to sail as a child, beating across Mount's Bay in an old National 12 dinghy. It's okay, he whispers, cradling her head as he starts to sing. Hush, little baby, don't say a word. Mama's gonna buy you a mockingbird. They're the only words he knows of the lullaby, but he repeats them a few times before laying her back down gently in the pram. It seems to have done the trick. His dad never got to see his grandchildren. Never knew his son had left Cornwall to become a doctor in London. "You available for babysitting?" a jogger asks as she runs past them. He grins back at her. "Fully booked, I'm afraid." "No surprise there," she calls out over her shoulder. The exchange makes him feel better after the hideous scene with the man and his phone. He's such a fool. Needs to chill out. He sets off down the steep maze hillside of the park towards the playground, big feet pounding beneath him. Against all odds, Tilly is still asleep as he slides the pram through the playground gate. Up ahead, he can see Tanya on one of the benches, and, to judge from her listing body, she is asleep too. A burst of panic like gunfire. Where's Freddy? He glances over at the swings, the rocky sandpit area, the roundabout. Freddy's nowhere to be seen. "Tanya!" he calls out, still 20 yards away. "Tanya!" he shouts, louder now. This time she sits up and looks around. "Where's Freddy?" "Shit, I'm sorry," she says, standing as Adam jogs up to her. "He was just over there, playing in the sand. He can't have gone far."
"He's not there anymore."
Adam tries hard not to sound accusatory.
"Freddy!"
he shouts, half-heartedly at first, as if he's calling him in from their garden.
"Freddy! Freddy!"
He's bellowing now. People stop and turn.
"We're looking for our son. 5 years old? About this high?"
He gestures with his hand. He can hear the tremor in his own voice, which scares him even more.
"Red t-shirt, blue shorts, white trainers.
With secret jet-powered rockets."
"Oh God, I'm so sorry, Adam."
Tanya stares out at the park.
"He can't have gone far."
"It's okay," Adam says. "It's not your fault. I shouldn't have gone for a run." Tilly starts to cry. Tanya leans down into the pram and picks her up.
"She needs feeding," she says.
"You stay here. I'll have one more look around and then call the police."
Adam sets off, heart thumping like a drum. The playground is a large area, enclosed by wrought iron fencing. If Freddy's no longer inside it, he must have gone out through one of the two gates, which swing shut automatically. It's not like him. Adam starts at one end, where, beyond the gate, a large, shallow lake is used for paddling. A quick glance at the water. Relax. Freddy knows not to go anywhere near it. He works his way around to the other side of the playground, scanning the grassy slope beyond. He's about to ring the police when he sees a woman in the distance, walking towards him, diagonally down the hill. In her arms, a boy in a red t-shirt and blue shorts. Freddy. No question. Adam lets out an involuntary sigh of relief.
"It's okay. He's here."
He calls across to Tanya, who's struggling to feed Tilly on the bench in the playground. Tilly is still crying.
"He's safe."
He starts to jog towards the woman. Freddy is bawling his knuckles in his eyes, the way he does when he's trying not to cry. But his face lights up as he sees Adam.
"Daddy!"
he yells. The woman lets him down. She's still 20 yards away, and Adam hasn't taken her in. He's more interested in Freddy, who runs down the slope and hugs him.
"Where have you been, you little monster?"
he says, lifting Freddy up in his arms.
"I found him over there,"
the woman says, turning to look back up at the hill as she comes over to join them.
"He seemed lost, so I was bringing him back down to the playground, where he said his mother was."
Adam swallows. He knows that voice, even though he hasn't heard it for more than 20 years. He would recognize it anywhere. Its raspy, textured tones shot through with the faintest of French accents. For a second, he avoids looking up. But then he lifts his gaze. It's Cleo. the woman who broke his heart at Cambridge and has haunted his dreams ever since. Older, of course, but just as he remembers her. Short, cropped hair, high cheekbones, and such big eyes, black as the leather jacket she's wearing.
Adam?
She says, seemingly as surprised as he is.
Oh my God, it is you.
Cleo? Adam clutches Freddy's hand a little tighter. What on earth are you doing here?
Just passing through, she says, her voice returning to a lazy drawl. Friends in Blackheath, you know. How about you?
I live here, over there. He waves in the direction of their house on Mays Hill. He remembers the frisson of danger he used to feel whenever he was in the same room as Cleo. He feels it again now. Fear, mixed with something else. More adrenaline than excitement. As if her empowered sexuality is some kind of primal challenge.
Call yourself a man? How incredible, she says. Freddy's a lovely little boy. Now I know why.
Adam shakes his head in disbelief, a blur of unfaithful emotions coursing through him. Is Cleo married? Has she got children herself? Where's she been all these years? He checks himself. You must come and meet my wife, Tanya, he says, glancing guiltily at her left hand. No wedding ring. She'll be so pleased to meet you. To thank you for finding Freddy. Chapter 3. Cambridge, May 1998. The big news is that the last night went well, despite my intense misgivings. As already confided to these pages, I didn't fluff any of my lines, and even Cleo seemed impressed. The audience, too. There was a stunned silence at the end of the play, when Dr. Faustus is dragged down to hell by demons. No forgiveness, no redemption for a man fired by hubris and his lust for limitless knowledge. Just a brutal, shocking conclusion to the deal he'd struck with the devil. A lifetime of power and pleasure in return for his soul. Lucifer and Mephistopheles. I gave them my soul for my cunning. As ever, though, my mind went blank when Cleo came round for a chat afterwards in the dressing room. I'd just spent 2 hours on stage exchanging some of the most memorable lines in English literature with her Mephistopheles. Was this the face that launched 1,000 ships and burnt the topless towers of Ilium? But when the curtain came down, I was tongue-tied. Again. Couldn't string two bloody words together. Articulate on stage as Dr. Faustus, a mumbling wreck as aspiring Dr. Adam the moment I came off. Am I really so awkward around women that I can't even talk? I thought acting might help make me more confident. Medicine too. After all, surgeons and actors have a lot in common. Big egos. Both work in a theatre. Boom, boom. Anyway, there I was in the ADC bar tonight for the after show, feeling out of my depth, surrounded by aspiring thesps, not to mention the ghosts of all those famous ADC alumni. Ian McKellen, Derek Jacobi, Simon Russell Beale, the Monty Python set. Given such a high hit rate, there's a fair chance that some of the people who were at the party this evening will be the famous names of tomorrow. Not me, that's for sure. That sense of anticipation, of career expectation, causes too much looking over people's shoulders for my liking. Having said that, I know we'll see Cleo's name in lights one day. Maybe in film rather than theatre. Everyone thinks so. Not just me. It was pretty raucous at the bar. The Deptford Society, who produced the play, was paying for drinks, and people were filling their boots. Cleo was further down the bar, and, emboldened by the free beer, I couldn't take my eyes off her. You'd have thought I'd have done enough of that on stage, sharing nearly all my scenes with her. But no, I've never seen anyone like Cleo. Her blatant femininity, the heightened sense of intimacy you feel in her company, the way she leans in close to you when she speaks, as if you're the only person who matters to her. Though that probably says more about my limited love life back home in Cornwall. She seems so at ease with her own body, comfortable in her skin without ever appearing vain.
Your tongue will fall off if it hangs out any further.
It was Louis, standing next to me at the bar and dressed from head to toe in black. Black t-shirt, battered long black leather jacket, and torn black jeans. He's a bit of a star, is Louis. A mature student, already hailed as a groundbreaking director at uni, an auteur, the next big thing in film. He's certainly got something, an aura of creativity that draws people into his circle, including Cleo. Money, too. There's little evidence that Louis has ever had to suffer for his art. Eton educated, he's one of those people who go out of their way to cover up their privilege. Take the yellow-stitched Doc Martens boots he always wears. Scuffed, unpolished, a calculated rejection of the shiny brogues he no doubt sported at school. He even had the luxury of choosing where to do his PhD. Oxford and Cambridge both made him offers, apparently. Rumour has it, he tossed a coin. He looked from my face to hers and back again. I'd seen him around with Cleo, exchanged occasional nods, but we'd never actually spoken to each other before, and I blushed, taking refuge in my pint of doom bar. That obvious, I managed to say. It was a toss-up between walking away or fessing up to my embarrassing infatuation. Was my tongue really hanging out? Ouch. I wanted the ground to swallow me up, particularly as I've always suspected that he and Cleo might be an item.
You're in good company.
Louis raised a small camcorder to his eye, a Sony Handycam. I watched him pan it across the crowded bar, as if it was the most natural thing in the world to do. No one appeared to react or even notice. Louis was seldom seen without his camcorder, but then the camera settled on Cleo. Instinctively, she seemed to know. She turned and scowled, eyes narrowing, chin raised in smouldering defiance. She's a natural in front of the camera. Isn't she? Louis whispered, still looking through the lens. The best movie stars never blink. I couldn't think of what to say. Mesmerized by Cleo's response to the camera, the way she stared back at Louis. Her gaze was fixed, unblinking, just as he said. After a few seconds, he lowered the camcorder and ordered a vodka and lime. Cleo turned away, as if in victory. Louis wasn't a member of the cast or crew and had to pay for his drink. Technically, he shouldn't have been there at all, as it was a private party. But I assume Cleo had invited him. Most hosts would let him in anyway, just to add a bit of cred to their party. I had time to look at him properly as he waited for his vodka. His pale face was sharp-edged and angular, like a bird of prey. His lips almost feminine, defined by a pronounced Cupid's bow.
You were very good tonight, he said, after his vodka had arrived. Very good.
Thanks, I said. Cleo was the star.
Isn't she always?
He pulled out a bag of tobacco.
It's a great play. One day I'd like to shoot the film. A modern take on the original Faustian pact. Not literal, you understand. And without any of the low comedy scenes.
No boxing popes round the ear, then? Just the important bit. Which are? I was keen to hear his take on Dr. Faustus. Our version stuck pretty closely to Marlowe's text, but the story is so rich in human insight, it's ripe for reinterpretation. Faustus, an ambitious but frustrated academic, craves a deeper knowledge of the universe, turns to magic, necromancy, and conjures up the demon Mephistopheles, Lucifer's agent. They strike a deal. Faustus can have infinite knowledge and power in return for giving his soul to Lucifer in 24 years' time. The way I played it, Faustus doesn't really believe that the devil will come calling. The date of reckoning is just too far ahead to be of concern. Ironically, though, he's unsure what to do with his newfound power, frittering it away on practical jokes on the Pope and lusting after Helen of Troy. But when the date finally approaches, he panics at the prospect of eternal damnation, the incessant pain. He doesn't repent, though, despite being given every opportunity. And when he calls out to Christ to save him, it's too late. By the end of the play, he certainly discovered more about the world and himself. Human pride comes at a hideous price. Limitless power is overrated, and free will is illusory. In true Calvinist fashion, Faustus was damned from the day he was born. I watched Louis lick a Rizzler paper and finish rolling his ciggy. He didn't seem in a hurry to offer his own interpretation. "I first heard of the play as a child," I said, filling the silence, "when I spotted Dr. Faustus carved into one of the concrete seats at the Minac, an open-air theatre not far from Land's End."
"The Minac?" Louis said, looking up. "Know it well."
"You do?" I was surprised. "My dad took me there far too young to watch King Lear. It's where I caught the acting bug." Louis smiled.
"A good place for Lear to rage in a storm. And Dr. Faustus."
1967. That was the date of the performance on the seat. I didn't add that when I was a tearaway teenager returning to port after a week of fishing at sea, I used to see the evening lights of the theatre shining out into the night sky from the cliffs and fantasize about being on stage rather than on deck.
"It's a play about the folly of human ambition," Louis said, cutting into my memories. "In many ways, Faustus was the ultimate overreacher and prepared to do anything, even sign away his own soul to achieve his goals, to gratify his desires."
He lit up.
"We all make them, you know, in our different ways," he continued, throwing back his head to exhale. "Deals with the devil to get what we want. Shameful trade-offs that come back to bite us. Faustian pacts." He held my eye. "Every day we wrestle with good and bad impulses. And at the end of our lives, the ledger of our actions, the decisions we've taken, must balance. As Dr. Faustus discovered."
I was about to show off, say something about the clash of Renaissance and medieval world views, when a student squeezed past and kissed Louis on the cheek. I moved aside awkwardly as the two men chatted, Louis's back to me. And then another student approached the bar. He had distinctive auburn hair and a light dusting of freckles, but he was not someone I recognized. For a second, I flattered myself that he had been waiting to congratulate me on my performance as Dr. Faustus. But he seemed nervous, shooting a furtive glance in Louis's direction. I could hardly hear his voice above the noise of the crowd, but his words were audible enough to shock me. "Don't have anything to do with that guy, or his films," he said,
Trust me. I mean it. He's not just a bad person. He looked around the bar again and leant in close. He's evil. Chapter 4. So, you were at uni with Adam, Tanya says as she blends a fruit smoothie in their new brushed metal and marble kitchen. She insisted on inviting Cleo back to the house, wanted to thank her for finding Freddy, and they have already exchanged numbers. Adam can't think of a less likely liaison, but they seem to have hit it off. It's as if Cleo's arrival in the house has energized Tanya, woken her up from her stupor in the park. Maybe it's just him who's the problem. We didn't know each other very well, Cleo says. Not for want of trying on Adam's part. She is outside the open back door, smoking a cigarette. Is she playing down their relationship at uni, to avoid any awkwardness with Tanya? Until my last term, she adds, glancing at Adam, who's still in his running gear. Tanya hates cigarette smoke, particularly when the children are around. But for some reason, it doesn't seem to be a problem today. Freddy is upstairs in his room, and Tilly is asleep in her pram in the hallway. It wouldn't surprise Adam if she even had a drag of Cleo's cigarette. I was an aspiring actor in those days, Adam says, fixing Cleo a black coffee. She turned down a healthy smoothie. Played a rather bad Dr. Faustus, opposite Cleo's wildly acclaimed Mephistopheles.
Hey, you were great.
Cleo exhales theatrically. Hardly, Adam says. The reviews, which he can still remember word for word, were okay. A workmanlike, perfectly serviceable Faustus. But it was Cleo who stole the show with her modern Mephistopheles. Clad in black leather trousers and jacket, she made a very good servant to Lucifer, doing the devil's work as she realized Faustus's increasingly frivolous wishes. Another Cambridge star is born. I thought Mephistopheles was a man, Tanya says. We were ahead of our time, Adam replies, relaxing a little. It was a very gender-fluid production.
I have never liked the use of gender and fluid together in that phrase, Cleo says, stubbing out her cigarette.
She walks back into the kitchen, staring at one of Tanya's rotors stuck on the fridge door.
Takes things in the wrong direction.
Oh, God. Adam concentrates on making the coffee. Tanya won't enjoy this conversation if Cleo gets earthy. Tanya's world is clean, like their kitchen. Efficient and wholesome. Maybe that's been the problem. She hasn't given in to the mayhem of motherhood. Waved a white flag and let chaos reign. Easy enough for him to say. He's always been messy. Drives Tanya mad with his piles of stuff left around the house. At work, he's more organized, which irritates Tanya even more.
I've never thought of it like that, Tanya says,
laughing as she opens the fridge door.
Whoa, what are those?
Cleo asks, peering inside the fridge. Adam looks over at the two women. Tanya must be a good foot taller. Cleo points to a row of plastic boxes arranged neatly on two shelves, each one labelled with a different food item. Strawberries, cucumbers, apples, snacks. They're for Freddy's lunchbox. Tanya holds the door open. He chooses his own food. A sort of DIY meal deal. Better chance of him eating it all. At least, that's the theory.
Adam thinks I've lost it.
Not true, Adam says. They've learnt to demarcate their roles in the kitchen, and Freddy's lunchbox has always been her domain, despite it involving children and food. He's the foodie. And early on in their marriage, they agreed that he would do all the cooking if she washed up. He used to try and clean up afterwards, too. He's a good but spectacularly messy cook. but always fell short of her impeccable standards.
That's so cool,
Cleo says, looking at the labelled boxes. My mother used to spoil me with dark chocolate truffles. Outside on the street, after they finished their smoothies and coffee, Tanya waves Cleo goodbye and thanks her again for retrieving Freddy.
Let's go for a walk in the park next time you're visiting your friends in Blackheath, Tanya adds. Text me.
Sure, Cleo says. I'd like that. Adam tries not to shake his head in disbelief.
I'll just walk Cleo down to the station. Back in a bit,
he says, failing to sound casual. His mind is still buzzing, trying to process Cleo's arrival today, and work out why the hell his wife is being so nice to her. Topsy-turvy Tanya.
How have you been keeping, anyway?
He asks Cleo as they head down Maze Hill.
Still acting?
Sometimes,
Cleo says, turning away. He's surprised. When she left uni in 1998, the internet was in its infancy. Friends reunited and Facebook had yet to be invented. He searched online everywhere for Cleo. All he had was a postal address in France, and regularly trawled the expanding internet in the years that followed, expecting to see her name in Hollywood. But he couldn't find her. Not a trace. Girlfriends came and went, but it was only when he met Tanya that he finally accepted that Cleo had gone. The dull ache for what might have been, replaced by a more realistic nostalgia.
I went back to live in France with my mother, Cleo continues. She was unwell, needed looking after. We're very close. When she was better, I travelled the world for a while before returning to France to be her full-time carer. She's not ill, just old. Needs help around the house. I promised myself she'd never go into a care home, even though she can afford it. Sometimes we get to help her when I come over to the UK.
She pauses.
To see friends.
It's not the path Adam expected Cleo to follow, but he's impressed by her filial devotion. She could have done anything in life. Born to an English mother who wrote literary novels and an often absent French father who was a successful stage actor, she grew up in a bright, bohemian world. The Lycée International school in Paris was followed by Cambridge, where she'd been a brilliant actor herself and sailed through her English degree.
I tried to stay in touch, he says. Wrote you a few letters.
At least 20. Maybe more.
I know.
You got them?
He asks, blushing, as he tries to recall what he wrote. The bad love poems. The quotations from Dr. Faustus comparing Cleo to Helen of Troy. Here will I dwell, for heaven be in these lips.
Oh God.
He stopped writing to her when he met Tanya. She nods.
I read them too.
And never replied to any of them. Cleo was always out of his league, but for a few days in the spring of her last year at Cambridge, she had allowed him to dream. He takes a deep breath, not sure whether to ask his next question.
Did you ever patch things up with Louis?
It's the first time he's mentioned Louis's name in years, and the sound of it sends a shiver through him. He's spent half his life trying to forget the man. To this day, Adam doesn't know the exact nature of the relationship between Louis and Cleo. Some said they were a couple. Others, that they were just good friends. Soulmates. They certainly slept with each other, but it wasn't an exclusive arrangement. All Adam knows is that for a while, there was something between them. A strange, fiery bond that seemed too combustible to last. Sure enough, they fell out spectacularly in her final term, which Adam found reassuring. It always upset him that Cleo could love a man like Louis.
Louis?
Cleo almost spits out the word. You must be kidding.
Chapter 5. May 1998.
What are you studying?
Louis asked me, glancing around the bar, a roly bobbin at his lips. I took another long draught of my beer, trying to process what had just been said to me by the guy with red hair. Evil is a strong word by anyone's standards, but the man could have had any number of reasons for bad-mouthing Louis. The ADC bar is a snake pit, full of petty rivalries and jealousies, far removed from the camaraderie of the swordfish back home. What I wouldn't give for a pint or three in somewhere like the Swordie. But there's no pub up here that comes even close. Cambridge isn't Newlyn, that's for sure. Maybe the redhead was a spurned lover. I looked up at Louis, trying to forget what I had heard. Louis's face was now close to mine. It was hard to hear each other above the din of drunken actors, and I was struck again by how ill he looked. It wasn't just the sallow skin, with telltale patches of what looked like atopic dermatitis or eczema. It was his eyes, bloodshot and watery. Hay fever? Maybe a corneal abrasion? Or just too many rollies? I'm a medic, I said. First year. He raised his eyebrows and seemed to adjust himself, stand a little taller. I've noticed this a lot in people recently, as if I might somehow be able to sense, as a future doctor, whether they are hungover or have eaten something unhealthy. At least he didn't ask me about some ailment or other, which is what people also do when they meet a medic. My choice of degree appeared to genuinely pique his interest. What I thought would be a quick bar chat turned into a discussion about my hopes and ambitions, my plan to become a consultant general paediatrician in London, and then one day move back to Cornwall, and about the long journey I've embarked on. 2 years of pre-clinical studies, 1 year of intercalation, followed by 3 years of clinical training in hospitals, and then a further 8 years of training before, all being well, becoming a consultant.
Maybe our paths will cross again, Louis said. My parents have a house in Cornwall. I go there often with my brother.
I'm amazed we've not met before, I said. In truth, I wasn't surprised at all. Let me guess. Rock? Where most of the moneyed second homers end up. He smiled.
Pulzeth, actually.
Near enough. It was never going to be Camborne.
I should be a keen surfer, shouldn't I?
He said. I couldn't think of a less likely candidate.
But the sea's not for me. I prefer the moors.
And the Minnack, I added.
And the Minnack, of course.
Louis's speech was educated and cut glass, despite the occasional dropped consonant, which made me more self-conscious of my own Cornish lilt. He was charming, too, at ease with conversation, those sculpted lips often breaking into a pinched, twitchy smile.
6 years here is a big investment, he said,
changing the subject as he looked around the crowded bar.
I imagine you have to keep your nose pretty clean.
How do you mean? I asked, still surprised that this apparent star of the arts scene was talking to me.
Aren't they very strict about that sort of thing? The powers that be? Do no harm and all that?
Louis was right. Even if do no harm was not actually in the original Hippocratic Oath, it was the first thing our director of studies explained to us when we arrived in college. As medical students, we have to go above and beyond, to work harder than other students and behave better, which is ironic, given that most medics are animals, partying the hardest, drinking the most. A police caution for Anything from fare evasion to possession of illegal drugs, drink driving to violence, can scupper a medical career before it's even started.
Your behaviour at all times, both in the clinical environment and outside of your studies, must justify the confidence that patients and the public place in you as a future member of the medical profession, Professor Beale told us, quoting from the General Medical Council's official guidance for students.
I have to be doubly careful, I said, as a medic who wants to work with children. How about you?
An expensive drug habit's de rigueur, if you wish to make it in the film world, Louis said, smiling.
I laughed. Is that what you're studying? Film? I knew the answer, but I didn't want to appear sycophantic. He nodded.
I'm doing a PhD. The first of 4 happy years, if they don't chuck me out.
What's it about? I asked, trying to sound interested. In truth, I wasn't too bothered, but my scheming brain was working overtime, already calculating that he might be able to help me see more of Cleo.
The aesthetics of evil in modern cinema.
I nodded as intelligently as I could. It's a skill you learn quickly here. Psycho? I offered, naming the first film that came into my head.
That sort of thing.
He paused.
But right now I'm working on another project. Looking for people to help me, in fact. As I say, your performance was impressive tonight. Accomplished. I was wondering whether you might want to appear in a small film of mine.
Appear in a small film of his? Accomplished. I stood a little more upright, tried to stay cool. Maybe my Dr. Faustus wasn't so bad after all.
Chapter 6. Adam and Cleo arrive at the station. It feels weird for him to be with her again, as if no time at all has passed. He glances at a camera further down the platform. Was it always pointing in their direction? He needs to get a grip, focus on reality, not the weird machinations of his overactive mind. According to the platform indicator, a train to Blackfriars is due in 1 minute.
It's been nice seeing you again, he says. What are the chances, eh?
Cleo looks at him, and he can't help but notice that her eyes, heavily lined with kohl, have changed in some imperceptible way. She glances down the platform, at the camera, and back at him again.
I was thinking,
she says, her voice even more husky.
It would be great to catch up. When you have a bit more time, maybe. I haven't seen anyone from uni for years. And I'm sorry how it all ended, you know? Wish it could have been different.
Adam swallows. He doesn't want to think about Cleo's last few months at uni. He's been over it all in his head 1,000 times. Cleo was an innocent party, caught up in something beyond her control. Louis was the cause of it all, and he disappeared off the face of the earth too.
You okay?
Cleo asks. He nods, still confused by her sudden appearance in his life again. She's the same, but somehow different. Is it her eyes? Or the way she angles her face upwards by a few degrees when she talks? She didn't used to do that except on stage, a tic she adopted to transform herself into the animated, threatening Mephistopheles. Adam checks up and down the platform, making sure no one is within earshot.
Can I ask you something?
He says, thrusting his hands deep into the pockets of his exercise hoodie.
Sure,
she replies. He takes a deep breath.
Was it really a coincidence, you being in the park today?
She pulls back from him, a quizzical expression on her face, as if she can't quite believe what he's just said. and then she cocks her head to one side to check that she's heard him correctly. He remembers that mannerism, like a blackbird listening for worms.
A coincidence?
She asks.
Of course it was a coincidence. What else could it have been? I had no idea you lived in Greenwich. If I'd known, I'd have come knocking at your door. What a strange question.
She laughs, staring at the ground as she dabs at a puddle with her foot. He needed to know, to hear her say the words, but he's still embarrassed. He's deluding himself again, just as he did at uni. Of course Cleo hadn't come to Greenwich to seek him out. Who's he kidding? She was passing through. Their meeting was pure chance. Serendipity. A catch-up would be great, he says, keen to move on. How long has it been? She hesitates before answering, glancing down the platform again.
Must be more than 20 years.
If you say so. He's never been very good on graduation dates. They only overlapped for a year as undergraduates. Adam stayed on for another 2 years and then did a further 3 years of clinical training.
Here comes my train, she says.
Adam turns to see it nosing around the bend.
How about tonight? A drink, in town.
A drink? His immediate impulse is to say no. Saturdays are movie nights at home with Tanya, Tilly permitting. But then he remembers that Tanya will be away. Cleo continues before he can say anything.
Bring Tanya along too, if you can get a babysitter.
She's going away this afternoon, he says. To stay with her parents. He didn't need to tell her that. She holds his gaze. Again, those eyes. What is it about them?
Oh, okay,
she says with a Gallic shrug.
So, text me if you fancy a drink. Tanya's got my number.
I'm on call tonight, he lies. Maybe another time, when you're back in the area. We can all meet up. But Cleo's already boarded the train, disappearing from his world as quickly as she entered it. Will he ever see her again? Should he? And then he realizes what it was about her eyes. Like the best movie stars. She didn't blink. Chapter 7. May, 1998. It sounds interesting, I said, throwing a glance down the bar. Cleo looked over in my direction and smiled. Was Louis's film project her doing? Had she put in a word on my behalf? What exactly do I have to do?
Just be yourself, Louis said. I'm doing a series of a life in the day of shorts. Nothing to trouble the jury at Cannes. Just a slice of old-school cinema vérité. You go about your normal day. I follow you around with my camera. Simple as that.
As if to demonstrate, he lifted his camcorder to his eye and started to film people at the bar again. And then, I'll present you with a copy of the finished article when we're done. He lowered the camera. Something to keep for posterity. To remind you of your time here when you're rich and famous. I imagine consultant pediatricians earn a fortune. I've no idea, I said. Medical students are notoriously ambitious, myself included, but I know I'm not studying medicine for the money. Believe me, my life is so boring, I added. This play is the first extracurricular thing I've done since I've arrived, and it might get me thrown off the course if my grades drop. It's all lectures, lectures, and more lectures in my world. Throw in some practical classes and supervisions, and that's the extent of my life. We do so much science in the preclinical years compared to the other medical schools. I can't see my life here making a film. Honestly, it would send people into a coma. He turned away, and I wondered if I'd offended him. Who knew? Maybe my mundane world could be made to look interesting in his expert hands. That's just what I'm after, Louis said. Snapshots of student life, vignettes of actualité. We're all here to work, after all. In the last film I made, I even managed to make an aspiring accountant's life seem interesting. Medicine must be more exciting than that. Possibly, I said. Maybe you should film me in my third year. What we call intercalation. The piss-up year, allegedly. We're encouraged to study something to broaden our horizons. History of art, that kind of thing. My life might be a little more interesting by then. I was bluffing. Much as I'd like to study the Newlyn School of Painters, I've already decided that I'll do a natural science topic for my third year. Something like physiology, development and neuroscience, PDN. I can't afford to waste my time here on a non-medicine related subject. I owe it to others. To Mum and Dad. Events might be a little manipulated in the film, Louis said. Curated. Okay. How do you mean? I've always felt Jean Rouch's docufiction is the best way to get to the truth. Perhaps we can ask Cleo to be involved, arrange for you to bump into her for a coffee. I blushed again, glancing over at Cleo, who was deep in conversation with another woman. I wish I didn't blush so easily. An overactive sympathetic nervous system, I guess. Just like Dad, who could blush for Britain. My ears started to burn too. That's not really part of my normal day, I said. Or hers, much as I'd like it to be. I quite understand if you don't want to participate. He drained his vodka as if in readiness to leave. No, it sounds intriguing, I said, trying to forget what the red-haired student had said about Louis and his films. Anything to keep in touch with Cleo now that the play was finished. She's more interested in you than you think, he added. I stared at him. Really? I despised the eagerness in my voice, but it was impossible to hide. Cleo interested in me?
She's never met anyone like you before, Louis said. She's curious.
The feeling was mutual.
Despite, or maybe because of, her extrovert nature, she's drawn to quiet people.
I was her man then. I could do quiet all day.
I'll drop by, he said. You're at St. Thomas's, right?
Yes, I replied. Most people just call it Tom's, but Louis seems very proper, possibly even a pedant, keen to get the little things right. Apparently, he did his undergraduate degree in classics at Oxford, and then I realised that I hadn't told him which college I was at, which struck me as odd. But maybe he'd read the play's programme, which included a small biography about each of us. Or perhaps Cleo had told him. I looked over to where she had been at the bar, but she was gone. Louis left a moment later. The place was still jumping, but I didn't want to stay late. Too much work to catch up on. And then, as I was about to leave, I saw the student again, the one who had warned me about Louis. He was over by the door, on his way out. I drained my pint and set off in pursuit. Hey! I said, outside on the street. He was 20 yards away, walking quickly. He turned to look back at me and carried on, almost breaking into a run, head down. I glanced up and down the empty road and jogged after him. Wait, I said. I just want to ask you about what you said back there. About Louis. I can't say anything else, he said, hurrying ahead of me. I shouldn't have talked to you. Please, leave me alone. Why did you call him evil? He stopped and turned to face me.
You should know, he said. You of all people.
How do you mean?
After tonight, the play, the pact Faustus made with Lucifer. Stay away from Louis, and stay away from me. If he sees me talking to you, he'll...
He'll what?
I was shocked by the fear in his eyes. I've got to go. Please, never speak to me again. You promise?
I watched him run off into the Cambridge night.
Okay, I said sarcastically to myself. I promise.
Chapter 8. She was nice, Tanya says, when Adam returns from the station. I can't believe you've never mentioned her before.
Tanya is wiping down the kitchen surfaces, Tilly hooked over one hip. She's awake and not crying, which is a bonus. Freddy is pushing a toy car across the floor at her feet. He's obsessed with cars, and Tanya seems animated, which could go either way.
Daddy!
Freddy says, driving the car up his trouser leg.
Hello, you.
Adam picks him up. Freddy continues to steer the car over his head and down the other side of his arm.
Hey, that tickles,
Adam says, and starts to tickle Freddy back until he's laughing uncontrollably.
He'll wet himself if you're not careful,
Tanya says, as Freddy begs Adam to stop. Freddy escapes and runs off to another room, driving his car across the walls, leaving tire marks. It was a mistake to have had the house painted, but Tanya insisted. New baby, new coat of paint. Thank God they didn't have twins. The walls would still be wet with the second coat.
I thought I'd mentioned her, Adam says.
He's only stayed in touch with a handful of people he met at Cambridge. Medics, mostly. And Ji Ma, of course. Godfather to Tilly. A computer science student from China, Ji became a close, if unlikely, friend at Cambridge, almost persuading him of the joys of video games. Almost. Tanya shakes her head.
Did you go out together?
She asks.
Not exactly, he says,
wrong-footed by her directness. He shouldn't be. Tanya has always been straight-talking, never one to tiptoe around issues.
But you wished you had, she says.
I mean, which man wouldn't? Adam feels uncomfortable talking about his past relationships, unlike Tanya, who is happy to chat about her previous partners. She had had one long-term relationship before she met Adam. He's never gone into much detail about his own modest love life. The art student who worked Saturdays at the Tate in St. Ives and used to let him in after hours to wander the empty galleries together. An older barmaid at the Saudi in Newlyn, who followed him down to the cellar one day and kissed him as he was changing barrels.
Come on, she's gorgeous, she says. That chopped pixie cut, the leather jacket, rock chick skirt, and what a voice! You couldn't make it up, if I was a man. I could never pull off a look like that.
It's true. Tanya couldn't be less like Cleo. If Cleo smoulders, Tanya is pure sunshine, a difference heightened by their contrasting physiques. Tanya is tall, blonde, and athletic. Cleo is short, dark, and petite. It was one reason he fell for Tanya. Meeting her was like a release, a chance to break free from the past.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.